Good evening. My name is Joanne Wisecheck, and whether you're here in person or joining us from the live stream, I'd like to welcome you to my third and final dissertation lecture entitled Stories. This lecture comprises music from that counts towards my third recital, but it has been spread over several performances, including tonight. And the commonality that links these works together is finding a way for composers and musicians to tell their stories. Steve Jobs of Apple and Pixar fame once said that the most powerful person in the world is the storyteller. The storyteller sets the vision, values, and agenda on an entire generation to come. This seemingly sage statement came as a point of frustration in response to what Walt Disney was doing at that time in the early 90s. And at that point in Jobs' career, he had established Apple and had been fired from his own company. But he'd go on to create Pixar, which would create Toy Story. In many ways, composers are also storytellers. Composers transport listeners to new worlds and introduce them to different perspectives. Let's explore a few narratives together. Our first story was inspired by the sounds of Cuba. There were elements of nostalgia and home for Tanya Leon when she was writing Cumba Cumbacan in 2011. A native of Havana, Cuba, Leon began writing and playing piano at age 4, composing at 13. Her mother, seeing her interest in music, enrolled her in the local conservatory. Leon would earn her bachelor's and master's degree in music, plus a certificate in accounting. Then she left Cuba as a refugee in 1967, came to New York, got into NYU, and did it all again. She got a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in music from NYU. She goes to New York and gets a Master of Fine Arts degree at NYU. She continues composing, starts conducting, and her career takes off. Leon has a remarkable career. To list just a few highlights, she is a founding member of a dance theater of Harlem. She is a founding and artistic director of Composers Now. And in 2021, she won the Pulitzer Prize in Music for her orchestral work, Stride. Leon shares that Cumba Cumbacan is a transliteration of sound and of a certain rhythm played by congueros, conga drummers, inspired by well-known musical gestures and melodies of the music of Cuba of the 1940s. I grew up dancing to this rhythm. The work is permeated with dance rhythms and percussive cues. It borrows inspiration from other popular dance influences, including the bembe, son cumbano, and danzón. An interesting compositional device that Leon layers in are these motivic elements from the opening theme into the middle bembe section. Let's listen to the bembe section, which occurs in the middle of the piece. The percussion groove is what gives it the characteristics of the bembe. Notice the rhythmic complexity in the upper woodwinds. Thank you. opening Motivos de un Son contains the same motive that you just heard, but it's not as obvious, and it's parsed out canonically between the woodwinds. The final part of the piece is the danzón, which is the official music genre and dance of Cuba. It's a slow partner dance with set footwork around syncopated beats that relies heavily on percussion. During the introduction, in a section called the paseo, dancers chat and select partners. They all start dancing again at precisely the same time due to a particular percussion pattern that's hard to miss. These various dance or percussion rhythms are inspired by Leon's love for her native country of Cuba. She goes on to share in the score that in New York City, she hears the way in which many of these rhythms have been influenced and shaped by other cultures, in particular the Cuban son and its influence on salsa music. This oral tradition and some of the finest storytelling we know. We now travel to England and meet Ruth Gipps. What is especially intriguing about British music making in the early 20th century is the vast array of and importance of women composers in their musical society, including Ruth Gipps. Ruth Gipps was a British composer and conductor. Her compositional output included works for orchestra, choir, wind, chamber music, and piano, as well as for radio. She attended the Royal College of Music, where she studied composition with Ray Vaughan Williams and Gordon Jacob. She earned a Doctor of Music degree from Durham University in 1948. Perhaps most interesting is that she founded and conducted the Portia Wind Ensemble in the 1950s, which was entirely comprised of women musicians. This is also the ensemble for which Seascapes was originally composed, and then also written for the double woodwind quintet, for which the performance you'll hear the recordings of tonight. Seascapes is also thought to be a work that was inspired by a trip to the coastal town of Broadstairs in Kent, where Gipps was giving lectures. She is quoted as having said, "I spent the night in a hotel right on the beach. I could hear the sea. I always loved the sound of the sea, and particularly storms." Overall, her compositions employ imaginative development of simple motivic material, and Seascapes is no exception. Compositionally, the music has three themes that are heard and repeated. The opening theme has the most obvious sea-like sound with passing of arpeggiated themes and phrases between woodwinds.
Thank you.
The next theme is rhythmically driven, perhaps depicting a jagged, torrential, storm-like facet of the sea. The final theme is a somber, reflective state of calm. Each of these themes returns in some capacity, sometimes reorchestrated, but they are all linked together with these beautiful cadenzas that showcase vibrant technique and musicianship of the players. In doing so, each of these themes and their repetition is telling the story of the sea. Our next piece brings us back closer to home with American composer Norman Dello Gioia and his fantasies on a theme by Haydn. Dello Gioia was born in New York City and came from a long line of church organists. His father was an organist and vocal coach for the Metropolitan Opera and provided his initial training, and throughout his youth, he would continue to hone his organ skills, so much so that he would win a scholarship to study organ at the Juilliard School of Music. After graduating from Juilliard, he would go on to study composition under Paul Hindemith at Tanglewood and the Juilliard School of Music. Dello Gioia served as professor of composition at a number of schools, including Sarah Lawrence College, Mann's College, and professor of music and dean of the Fine and Applied Arts School of Boston University. He also served as director of the Ford Foundation's Contemporary Music Project from 1959 to 1973, a project which provided financing to place young composers in high schools to compose music for school ensembles. Among his many awards are the Pulitzer Prize in 1957 for Meditations on Ecclesiastes, and the Emmy Award for Scenes from the Louvre in 1965. The thematic material used by Dello Gioia in Fantasies on a Theme by Haydn is the first theme of the fourth movement of Haydn's String Quartet, Opus 74, number 2. This theme returns in a variety of fragments and full reinstatements that Dello Gioia plays with by paying homage to the composer he holds dear. This is that theme. Although Dello Gioia endeavors to reinvent this theme in three different ways from this point forward, from the very beginning of the work, we hear a very distinctive motive that music educator Mark Fonder calls the cuckoo theme, which comes alongside the theme throughout the work. This is a touch of Dello Gioia's intermixed ideas with Haydn, and here is that cuckoo motive. ¶¶ based off of the theme from Haydn and Della Gioia's original Cuckoo motive, Della Gioia moves forward with three fantasies. He provides the following description of his work. The three motives are a constantly varied examination of Haydn's basic idea. The bubbling humor of the first and third fantasies flank a second, which is intensely lyric. In the final sense, it is my homage to a composer who will always remain contemporary. So in this way, Della Gioia tells Haydn's compositional story by reliving the ways in which he makes us laugh with surprising silence and strong dynamic outbursts, but also through intensely lyrical gestures. Tonight, I am thrilled to share a fairly new story. Tonight's performance of Five Elements by Yunfei Li is a part of a consortium premiere. It was commissioned by Stephen D. Davis and Anya Pagarilava. I tried, Anya. premiered by the University of Missouri Kansas City Conservatory Wind Symphony. I believe Yunfei and Anya are joining us via live stream tonight, so thank you very much for tuning in. Yunfei has a BA in electronic music production from Central Conservatory of Music in Beijing, a Master of Music and Composition from the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, and she is currently pursuing her Doctorate of Music in Composition at the University of Missouri Kansas City Conservatory. She has a diverse compositional output, having music for solo instrumental chamber groups, large ensemble, digital and mixed media, as well as film. Her works have been performed by a variety of ensembles, including Transient Canvas, the Red Clay Saxophone Quartet, Domino Ensemble, Plaza Winds, and After Tonight, the University of Michigan Graduate Recital Chamber Winds. This piece might have one of the most obvious connections to the theme of this lecture because its goal is of storytelling. It's telling the story of five elements based around this concept of I Ching, which tells the story of nature's patterns through time. This work has five movements that you will hear tonight in this order: metal, wood, water, fire, and earth. These five fundamental elements shape the framework of our world, and they are in this constant state of flux and counterbalance that shape our world. Yunfei also expresses her program note, her concern for climate change, as a source of inspiration, and this is pretty powerful in light of all that we've been experiencing through this year. Each of her movements are quite short, so I didn't want to play anything and ruin the surprise. But as you listen, I think that she really does a great job of trying to paint an aural image of the titles. So for example, with metal, she really goes after, with each articulation, this metallic sound with the setting of each of the instruments, just a very sharp contrast. Even with her contrast with dynamics, being able to really articulate very clearly a metallic sound. I think Yunfei's program now is really beautiful, and I've tried to summarize and retell the story without taking too much away from its authenticity. We end with the Sinfonietta de Camera, Opus 38 by Salvador Brotons, which is the one piece on the program without a programmatic element to it. So the story connection lies with the composer. Brotons proudly hails from Barcelona, Spain. He comes from a long line of musicians, specifically flute players. He continued his musical studies at Barcelona Music Conservatory, where he earned advanced degrees in flute, composition, and conducting. In 1985, he won a Fulbright scholarship and moved to the US, where he obtained a doctorate in music from Florida State University, which is where he wrote the Sinfonietta that you'll hear tonight at age 26. He maintains an active career as a conductor and teacher. Since 2001, he has been a professor of composition and orchestra and conducting at the Escola Superior de Música de Catalunya. He has been the conductor and music director of the Vancouver Symphony Orchestra since 1991, where he is actually has a performance tonight, right now, I believe. The instrumentation of the Sinfonietta is written for two flutes, two clarinets, two bassoons, two horns, trumpet, trombone, tuba, and one percussionist. It is written like a small symphony with four contrasting movements. Each movement has carefully chosen motives and harmonies that return throughout. The second movement is like a Technicolor library or Technicolor lullaby with emotional highs followed by delicate solos between the clarinet and tuba and piccolo, as well as these tiny little entrances by the percussionist. The final movement in particular begins with a menacing brass chorale followed by this frenzied mixed meter race to the end. I'm excited for the musicians to share their preparation with you. This music is all about contrast. While this music is not programmatic, I truly believe that this story is Dr. Brotons. That his music came from his heart, as he would say, the story is his. It is about winning a Fulbright, coming to a country that is not his own, and then having the opportunity to compose music for you to hear tonight. This is not a piece that gets performed very often. There's only one recording that I could find available, so I'm excited to have the opportunity to share it with you tonight. In closing, we heard the story of Tania Leon's music from Cuba. We traveled to England and heard music from the sea. We listened to Dello Joyo's homage to Haydn, and we've prepared ourselves to share with you Yunfei and Brotons' works. Although it might be more musical to compare, Steve Jobs' opening quote, a composer sets the vision, values, and voice for an entire generation to come. I hope you enjoy our performance this evening. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you.